I think that just leaves me to hand over to Ludger to bring us the Word of God.
Good morning. Man I very much admired, who's now gone to be with the Lord, Reinhard Bonnke, one of my countrymen. He would always say, "Oh, I've got to start preaching now, because if I don't, I'm going to explode." He is so full of his message usually. I don't think I feel quite like that, but... Well, let's pray. So, Heavenly Father, we pray. Today, this will not just be a message that we hear, but it'll be something that touches our hearts and minds. It'll be something that comes from you, Lord, today. We pray that we'll hear you above everything else and beyond everything else, Lord. Amen. So my reading comes from Ephesians chapter 4, beginning at verse 1. So it's a letter that Paul wrote from prison. And my subject will be how the Lord Jesus will build his church. How he will build his church. God wants to build his church. So Ephesians chapter 1, chapter 4, verse 1. As a prisoner of the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. It's a beautiful word, agape, love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he led captives in his train and gave gifts to men. What does he ascended mean, except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. It was he, that one who ascended, who had descended and then ascended, Jesus. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for the works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach the unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching, by the cunning of and craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. So this is the passage I'm going to use because I believe it gives us the blueprint of how Jesus wants to build his church. I believe it's right there in that passage. And of course, the purpose why he's doing it as well, so that we would grow into becoming like him. So it's all there. I mean, some people have these clever ways of putting things. They say you should shape your sermon so that you tell them what you're going to tell them, and then you tell them, and then you tell them what you told them. I wish I was as clever as that. I can't quite do that. And in fact, I've made loads of notes because the Lord was just speaking to me about this subject in the night. And so my notes are copious, but I thought, well, if I follow those, that's going to be a very long sermon, so I'll depart from the notes. Take the risk and it might be longer. See, I preach the eternal gospel. So Sorry about that. But you see, I believe there's a blueprint in there how he wants to build his church. And this connects, of course. It doesn't say it in here, this is how I'm going to build my church. But it says this is what he's done. He's given us gifts from above. And some of us have spiritual gifts. All of us should have spiritual gifts. Gifts from the Holy Spirit. But here it tells us Christ gives gifts in this passage. And it tells us that it was he. I'm going to skip all those beginning verses. If you could put that part up, Dave, from verse 11 onwards, sort of. It was he who gave to some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, some to be pastors and teachers. I think that's the blueprint. Because it says here, to prepare God's people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. That's how he's going to build his body up, which is an image of the church, the body of Christ. Another image of the church is, of course, that he's building us into a temple. And that connects us with the subjects that I've been talking about a couple of weeks ago. Twice, 2 weeks running, I've been talking about that God has spoken to us in the Old Testament and New Testament that he's going to restore the fallen tent of David, the fallen, broken tabernacle of David, which is all about his presence and about worship. The tabernacle of David was set up so that he would bring the Ark of the Covenant into it, and that which represents the presence of God, and that 24/7 worship would take place reflecting what's going on in heaven. So he's building this tent, this tabernacle. The church is going to be a worshiping church, but it's also going to have to be a church that's equipped to change the world. And I think he's going to do it by giving us apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, which we call the fivefold ministries. It's increasingly being taught and understood, and books being written about the fivefold ministry, what that does. But what that is saying to me, and hopefully to you, that must mean more than just those prophets and apostles that have gone before us in the past and became the foundation on which he built. It must mean more than that. It can't be that it's not for today. Because, let me ask you this, do we see around us that we are prepared for every work of service as a people of God? Are we united and grown into maturity, become like Jesus? Are we there? Are we so completely one? We're not, are we? We're not completely built up as a church. We're not finished. We're a work in progress. And so if he says that's how he's going to do it, we need those ministries, all five of them. Okay, let me backtrack a little bit in time, not in what I've already said. Okay, so history. We have a church history that we're going to have somebody fantastic teach about that knows a lot more than I do know about it in September. But in about 400 years ago, 1600 somewhere there or something like that, there was what happened is the Reformation. The Reformation is still the foundation on which we still stand today. We always build on what's gone before us, hasn't it? And the Reformation was necessary because the church had become completely departed from it was originally meant to be, I believe. Became totally politicized. It was totally corrupt. It was had teaching that was gone off track, no longer the scriptures. And the Reformation said scripture only, nothing else. Let's cut everything else away. And the Reformation was necessary and good, but also it had its shortcomings. It was a very tough time for the church. And what happened in the Reformation, it wasn't only that they wanted God to go back to scripture and build a church beautifully like scripture would tell them. They took what they knew and went back to the scriptures, but in a process they rejected everything that Catholicism stood for. And they also rejected miracles, because the Roman Catholic Church believed in miracles. So they rejected that. And it's understandable because they misused it in the Catholic Church before the Reformation, because you can pay for miracles, that kind of thing. And it was abused and misused and missed and wrongly taught in many, many ways. And they used the miracles in order to sanctify people, and thinking that the church had the authority to declare somebody a saint, when I think only God has that authority. That's my opinion. having come from a Roman Catholic background. Never mind. Okay, so not too much about that. I don't want to go on that. But that was one of the consequences of the Reformation, that miracles were rejected. And so we became a church that really believes the Word of God and believes that in history He's spoken and He's done things, but we didn't believe for many years that He still does it today. And of course we're discovering He is. He never stopped doing it, in fact. So that was the Reformation. So then after the Reformation, more and more things began to change and happen to the church. And God brought, particularly to this nation, to these islands, brought moves of revival over and over, and connected the British Isles with the colonies and with America, and brought revivals throughout the world through different individuals and groups of people, Wesleys, Whitfield, etc. Loads of men in our history brought the move of the Holy Spirit. And so about now almost 200 years ago, we're at the turn of the century from the 19th to the 20th century, the move of God came and the Pentecostal movement was born. And then later in the 1970s, 80s, 90s, the charismatic movement came into the churches, which is basically the same as Pentecostalism, except that it came to the mainstream churches. The Anglicans received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The Catholics received it. The Baptists, the traditional Baptists, the Methodists, they were all coming into knowledge and understanding that the Holy Spirit still moves today and gives gifts to men. And so prophecy came into the church and people began to speak in other tongues and did all kinds of things, and healings happened and healing services. And so the church is moving forward and forward and forward into, again, rediscovering the supernatural ministry of the Holy Spirit. So that's the history we're living in. And now I believe we're living in the most exciting times. Because now what we're seeing is not only through those movements has God restored the prophecy to the church, and here believing that we can hear Him and He'll speak to our hearts by His Spirit, but also He's restoring apostles. Now, that might sound very strange to you. If you read any of my pastoral letters over the last few years, they're a little bit long, maybe boring, I don't know. But but then you would have seen me writing about the church, the ecclesia, and also apostolic ministry. Now, let me explain a little bit more about that now. Okay, so I call them the fivefold. Many people do. Some people think pastors and teachers are very closely connected. They're almost the same. I don't think they're quite, but they're connected. Now, this is, I believe, what Jesus is raising up and building His church with, that is giving us those fivefold ministries. And when they're all in place, the church will be built up and become mature. It will know its Lord. It will become more and more like Him. It will be connected with Him. What we have is, from the Reformation onwards and perhaps even before, everyone expects a church leader to be a real pastor, to be visiting the sick, to visiting the elderly, to go and talk to anyone in trouble, to invite anyone into the church who needs help. Say, come to us, we'll take care of you. The best image that anybody thinks of Jesus, and we're thinking, by the way, we're thinking of Jesus very much like we're thinking of the church, is that picture there on that window, the shepherd who carries a sheep on his shoulders. And that's what Jesus is. He is the shepherd, which is why we were content with that. We thought this is what Jesus wants. His church, his leaders need to be shepherds like that. And yes, David was one of those prototypes of shepherd king, David, king of Israel. And yeah, so that's a part of it, yes, but it's only one part of those fivefold leadership structures. And we very wonderfully expect that want to see that in the churches, that all its leaders are shepherds like that, pastors. The problem with that is a pastor will say, come to me if you're in trouble, I'll help you, I'll be there 24/7. You can call me anytime, I'm ready to help you. Come in. And that that way of being church, to have the leader do that. Thousands every month leave the ministry worldwide because they're burnt out, they're rock bottom, they can't do it anymore, they've given out everything they had, and they leave the ministry. There's American statistics that literally thousands leave the ministry monthly. Yes, new ones come up, new ones get raised up, but they're wearing themselves out because it's not the full picture of what the church should be and church leadership should be. And so we accept them. We accept their main focus of a pastor is to make sure the sheep are all okay. They're all looked after. All the hurts are healed. All the troubles are being soothed. And we need that. We need pastors. We need them. And then you have some who are primarily teachers in their calling, and they're a bit like me. They preach the eternal gospel. They go on and on and on, and you think, oh, that was a bit long, that sermon. And the teacher will think, what, that wasn't long? You barely scratched the surface about what I wanted to teach you. I'm so full of this stuff that I want to teach you. I want you to grow and learn. And we want to grow and learn, don't we? But to a degree, if it's a two-hour sermon, we think, well, it's a little bit over the top, isn't it? I've listened to more than 1 hour sermons and not fallen asleep, believe it or not, because they're just so full of it, so full of the Holy Spirit. It's a real anointing and a blessing on that. I'm going to resist preaching for an hour, but but that's what a church would be like that has a teacher as its leader. And the teacher, like, will put the pulpit right at the front. That's the most important part of any church, he will say, the pulpit. You've got to teach the flock, and the teacher will say, you need to know this. But that means it's not complete. It's incomplete, because you need the pastors. And then you have those who have been called and gifted as prophets. Now, there's a difference between the gift of prophecy that comes from the Holy Spirit. I believe everyone who is filled with the Spirit of God should be able to hear the voice of God. In fact, Jesus said, my sheep will know my voice. So we all should hear his voice. So there must be a difference what is meant here. And that's the difference is this, that this is a ministry, a full-time call. It's something that God does. It's not a gift that you pray for and receive. It's a calling that comes from God. And it needs to be confirmed by God that you're called to be it, to be a prophet. And it needs to be confirmed by the church that they see it. Now, in recent years, like I said, in our history, we've begun to accept again that prophets are possible and likely and real should be among us. We believe it. We've learned how to discern and made many mistakes and got it wrong and how we deal with prophecy in the church, but we're growing and learning. And I believe there are some who are in their infancy and some have gone to some maturity, and I have seen actually, I would say about two generations now, people who have passed away who were worldwide renowned for their prophetic gift, and there are present ones, and there are some still growing into it. And it's something that you grow into. It's not instant. It's just like the disciples that Jesus called, that they needed to learn a lot, didn't they, from him. And so, but we've come to accept that prophets are part of it. And so a man who is prophetic, often like myself, I would see myself sort of, I don't believe in titles, by the way, but I believe that that's part of my calling because some others have told me. But also, part of that will be teaching. So the pastors will be teachers, and the teachers will have that as their predominant thing in the fivefold calling. And the prophets will be teaching, and when they teach, they speak the words of God that they've heard and the visions that they've had, and they teach the church. Never anything new other than what Scripture already is saying. If you contradict Scripture, you've gone off track. That's the linchpin, that's the testing point. Scripture is the one thing that is constant. And so we've accepted those four generally already. Now the fifth one we don't understand so much about yet. And we're learning, and more books have been written about it, and more leaders in the nation and in the world are beginning to understand what this is all about. So, apostles, is it really possible that we might have them among us today? Is it possible? Now, okay, so the Eastern Church, in its history, separated from the Western Roman Church very early on, and the Eastern Church retained the New Testament in the original language, which is Greek, which was its English of its day. Everybody spoke Greek who wanted to communicate to anyone. They wouldn't learn Greek in those days, and that's why the New Testament is written in Greek. And so the Eastern Church retained Greek as their scriptures, whereas the Western Church took Latin. When I was a kid, the services were still in Latin in the Catholic Church. Can you believe it? I'm so old. But anyway, so the Eastern Church retained it. And because they retained it, they had some language things that gave them an advantage. So, for example, they know, for example, that an apostle just simply means somebody who's sent by God. So Jesus said, "The Father sent me." So in Greek that says, apostolos, he sent me, that's the verb, he sent me. So when Jesus says, the Father sent me, and if you believe in me, you believe in the one who sent me, apostolos me. The Eastern Church had an advantage over us to see that connection. And also, so then in the Gospels, for example, Jesus sends out the 12 apostles to go ahead of him. He sends them again, apostolos. Sends them ahead of him to go to every village to prepare the way for him to go there. And they were supposed to preach and heal the sick and all that kind of stuff that he did. And then later on, he sent another 70. So altogether, he sent 82 people ahead of him, preparing them, training them on the job, how to do the job of healing, preaching, or making sure the kingdom of God comes and invades every community. Now, the Eastern Church calls those 70s apostles, because Jesus apostolos them, he sent them. Interesting, isn't it? So the Eastern Church had already thought there's more than 12 apostles because of this language advantage that they had. Okay, so that's a simple explanation of apostles. But, you see, when Jesus used a word like that, which I believe he did in his time, he took something that already had a secular significance and meaning. And so even further in history, before the Roman Empire, there was a Greek Empire, which is why Greek was so widely spoken. And the Greeks changed the culture wherever they went. They brought with them musicians, artists, they brought their language wherever they went and conquered. And they coined this word apostle to mean that somebody who has that task to go into the conquered lands to Greek, make them Greek, Hellenize them would be the word, Hellenize them. And the Romans took that word over. They thought, this is a good concept, we need to do the same. Because whenever they conquered some land with their armies, the Romans, they came to these isles too, didn't they? And conquered, and as soon as the army moved on, it just all reverted back to what it was before. It didn't become like Rome. So they said, well, you've got to do something. We've got to culturize. We want everything to become like Rome. So that they took some of their generals and called them apostles and gave them the task to go with those armies and stay behind and change the culture of the conquered land and city. So that's the task of the apostle, to change the culture. Fascinating, isn't it? I find it fascinating. But Jesus takes a word that had already a secular meaning and says, that's what you're going to be. You're going to be culture changers, world changers. Just like I am, Jesus said, because I'm sent by the Father and I'm sending you. And we should be all an apostolic church, a sent church to make disciples, aren't we? That's our task. But most of us haven't got an image of the church that says this is a world-changing force. They're going to conquer the world and change it and make it feel like heaven. Doesn't feel like that, does it? Because we have lost this image of what the church should really be. Because we've lost what Jesus was. You see, he wasn't just a shepherd who took care of the sheep. He was also tough. He was the evangelist who would, when the crowds came and said, "We want healing, we want to hear your teaching, we want to hear you," he said, he would hide for a whole night and pray. And then the disciples find him eventually somewhere hiding and praying. And he said, "Everyone's looking for you," and says, "We've got to move on. Go to the next village." He wasn't persuaded that they needed him anymore. He needed to go further. Just like the evangelist. If an evangelist leads the church, he would want everybody to say, "What are you doing here? Get ready. Go out there. Share your faith. Do you know how many people are dying right now while you haven't shared the faith with them and they end up in hell?" That's what the attitude of an evangelist would be. He wouldn't be a pastor. He can't be all those things because you can't have in one human being a pastor, a shepherd, an evangelist doing it all at the same time. When the pastors who are just looking at the pastoral work are already worn out and quitting their jobs. Imagine if you have an evangelist's heart and you just want to see the lost saved all the time and preach the gospel and want it to reach everyone, every home, and transform the world that way. If that's your focus, you're going to say to your church, "Get out your seats, bring your friends next time. Don't come alone. Don't come without friends." We think, "Oh, the pastors, it's all right. We look after each other. We make each other feel comfortable. We'd be nice." The evangelist said, "Don't be too comfortable. Get out there." Yeah? Jesus was like that as well as being the pastor. And Jesus was also the prophet. I've already shown you that, haven't I? When he was at the house of a Pharisee and at a meal, a woman came to him and she wept and wet his feet with her tears. Because she was repentant, she wiped his feet with her hair, his feet. She anointed him with a perfume on his feet. And the Pharisee said, "If that man was a real prophet, he would know what kind of woman is touching him. She's a sinner. Possibly a prostitute, we don't know." But she was repentant and wept. And Jesus not only knew her heart, he knew the heart of the Pharisee too. And he said, "Simon, do you see this woman? I came, you did not offer me water to wash my feet. When I came, you did not anoint me with oil to welcome me as one of your honored guests." That's what he was saying. I'm paraphrasing. "And when I came..." But she hasn't stopped. She's anointed my feet with oil. She's washed my feet with her tear. Her many sins are forgiven because she loved so much. So he is a real prophet. He knew the hearts and the thoughts of people. He was all those things, but he was also the original apostle, the first, the cornerstone. And he changed the world. We're still changing the world through us. Through what he's done, he changed the world. He brought the culture of heaven with him when he came. And so that wherever he walks and wherever he's proclaimed and wherever we grow into his likeness and become like him, the culture will be like heaven. There will be continual worship like there is in the tabernacle of David, the tent of David. We will change the world. We are supposed to be world changers. When we go to work, it's not just somebody going to work. You're bringing heaven's culture with you. And so you see, if you have an apostle lead the church, the whole thing changes. The whole thing becomes complete. Somebody who has not only the primary focus of the teacher, like I said, is to teach. The primary focus of the pastor is make sure we're all okay. Primary focus of the evangelist is the lost soul's got to be saved. The primary focus of the prophet is we've got to hear the voice of the Lord. The primary focus of the apostle is we need heaven's culture. We need heaven's culture here. We need the presence of God. We need him to manifest among us. We need to know what he's like. And we need to reflect him and be like him. And so when the apostle comes into the picture and takes his place, her place, not gender related, sorry, but when the apostle takes their place, they will change all the other ministries. Because suddenly, The pastor will know why we're making people whole. He will know that it's so that heaven can be represented better here. So that all the illness, there's no illness in heaven, is there? There's no tears in heaven. Yes, they may grieve over the state of the world because they can see that now, but one day he's going to wipe away all the tears from our faces, isn't he? In heaven, there's the presence of God. You cannot get away from it, so heavy. The glory fills it. If that fills the earth, everything changes. Everything. And suddenly, there is no hierarchy, really, among these leaders, because in heaven's culture, a leader does not dominate. He's not at the top. Actually, he's at the bottom. Right at the bottom. He's the foundation. He pushes everyone up. He empowers everyone. The original apostle Jesus empowered everyone that he taught and trained and sent them out. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. He said, now you go in that authority. I'm sending you in that same authority. He empowers. So there isn't wrangling for position. In fact, the apostle will say, well, heaven's culture is this. I lay down my life. You walk all over me. I push you up as best as I can. I become the foundation on which you can build. I don't want to be known. I don't want to be seen. I'm going to serve like Jesus served. It's this funny thing we can't get our heads around as the earth is so different, so completely opposite, isn't it? Anyone who has authority says, well, you better bow to my authority, okay? I mean, yeah. Jesus said, I have authority that's greater than what you can imagine. I say the word and it happens. But I lay down my life. So there's no hierarchy then, suddenly, when you get that kind of leadership structure. But who wants to lay down their life? If that's your purpose in life, to lay it down for others, then you can become a leader. He challenged his disciples, didn't he, with that kind of word. And so suddenly, the pastors know it's all about the presence. It's all about changing our world and making it like heaven. Suddenly, the teachers know, and they will teach how to submit to authority out of reverence for Jesus. And suddenly, the prophets know, I've got a covering. An apostle who's been commissioned by Jesus himself. See, the apostle Paul, every letter he wrote said, it's from the apostle Paul, an apostle by the will of God, appointed by Jesus himself. None of those ministries you can say, I want to be that. They're given by Jesus, they're chosen by Jesus, and they will have had an encounter with the risen Jesus. And believe me, the encounters with the risen Jesus are more real nowadays than they've ever been in history. They are more clear, and the commissioning that Jesus is doing, and as he's walking the earth, he's commissioning men and women and saying, you're going to be my apostle. You're going to be a prophet for me. You're going to be a teacher who's going to teach my way to people. And those ministries are not just gifts, not just spiritual gifts or natural gifts. They are ministries and anointings that come from heaven. They're given to build the church up into what it should be. And I think if the church begins to realize this is who we are, and if our culture gets changed to become like that, we will change the culture of the world around us. That's our task. Have I lost anyone yet? Have I lost you? Have you gone asleep? And so let me pray. Father, will you help us to see our role and the role of the church and what it should look like? And help us to see that you're building your church. And you're doing it in your way, with your blueprint, your plan that you've already put in place. And Lord, we want to see those very things. We want to see your presence among us. We want lives transformed. Will you transform my life, Lord? Will you help me to recognize in others what you're already doing and submit to them out of reverence for you? Father, we bless you and we honor you because you're so good to us. And we thank you for the leaders that you already have given us. We thank you for the archbishops that we have, Justin Welby, Stephen Cottrell. We thank you for our bishop, Martin. We thank you for our faithful, wonderful Queen, the head of the Church of England. We pray, Father, that you will impart to them a vision of their apostolic call to transform the world, to transform the church. Empower them, Lord, by your Holy Spirit. And Lord, help us. Help us to empower them by our love for them and our submission to them. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Do you feel the world is broken? Do you feel the shadows deepen? Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? Do you wish that you could see it all made new? Is all creation groaning? Coming, is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? Messiah, hold forever though.